When I was growing up, one of my earliest memories was my fourth birthday party, which was Scooby-Doo themed. I grew up watching the old cartoons from Blockbuster. When I exhausted the original series, I moved on to the direct-to-DVD movies, and I loved them too. All this to say, I'm probably one of the easiest people to sucker in with Scooby-Doo nostalgia. So what the hell happened here? I wasn't even planning on reviewing Scoob, but I threw the movie on one night while waiting for food delivery and I just can't keep my thoughts to myself. It's one of the more bizarre movies I've seen, not because it's actually wacky or weird, but bizarre in the way the movie's intentions seem to actively oppose each other. And that's what I want to examine as we break down the curious case of 2020's Scoob. The movie opens with young Shaggy and Scooby on a boardwalk, and their paths converge for the first time when Shaggy protects Scooby from being captured for stealing meat from a vendor. Now, this opening has a couple different problems. For one, something about the animation feels sterile to me. I think a big issue with it is the sky. It feels so empty and you can't see anything in the distance. I know it's a small detail, but it has a big impact on how the world feels. Filling this space with, I don't know, trees, more clouds, a coastal mountain, it would just feel more alive. Strangely enough though, this isn't even a constant issue through the movie. There are several shots that look pretty good. I did some digging on if this scene had maybe been added in later, but found out that apparently, the entire art department had been reshuffled during production.
We had an earlier art department for a different version, and some of those designs, we pulled them into this look.
That might explain some weird visual moments now and again. Things feel like they don't quite fit together. That's going to be a running theme in this review, you'll notice. Back to the introduction, there's also this part where Shaggy names Scooby-Doo.
Is he your dog?
He's, like, totally mine.
What's his name?
His name's Scooby.
Middle name?
Doobie?
Last name?
Doo.
All right.
Solo.
Sure, I guess this explains why Scooby Snacks and Scooby-Doo have the same name, but did we really need this? The origin of Scooby's name is that Shaggy borrowed it on the spot from a branded box he was eating from. It doesn't add any emotional weight to it. And speaking of emotional weight, the characters in the scene feel sanitized. All we know about Shaggy is that he's lonely and wants friends, and he doesn't tell his mom about that. Maybe if they went deeper into that, like maybe his mom neglects him most of the time or there's some other reason he didn't tell her, but he goes home and things seem fine there. A compelling relationship is built out of two people who each have something the other needs. And it needs to be deeper than needing a relationship. As is, the emotion of this bond between them feels very weak. And that's a big problem because that's explicitly meant to be the core of the story.
It was really centering on Scooby and Shaggy and their friendship and their relationship. They're really the stars. This is really their story.
I know I sound like I'm nitpicking, but if this is the cornerstone upon which the film is built, it has to be absolutely solid. Anyways, that Halloween, they meet Velma, Daphne, and Fred. They go into a haunted house, they bust a ghost, and about 11 minutes in, we get a little intro to how they became the Mystery Gang. Alright, so this is where the Scooby-Doo-ness starts. We get a fun little remake of the classic cartoon intro, which is nice, I like it. And then we come to the present day, the gang is sitting at a cafe and...
Oh, whoopee, a diner. I'll have a napkin and some hand sanitizer.
Whoa, man, it's Simon Cowell!
What?
So, yeah, Simon Cowell meets the Mystery Gang because he wants to invest in them so they can become a business. But he's not willing to put the money down as long as Shaggy and Scooby are part of the team. Gee, this is exactly what Scooby-Doo is missing. Angel investor politics and startup culture. Offended, the pair go to the bowling alley.
You believe the nerve of that dude? Simon Cowell thinks friendship won't save the day.
What does he know?
Yep. That's right. Simon Cowell is a major part of these characters' motivations. Simon Cowell is an integral part of the story of a Scooby-Doo movie. And yes, I know the franchise has featured guest stars as far back as the 70s. That doesn't make it best practice. I mean, what really has a stronger impression? Scooby-Doo meets the ghost of Redbeard, or Scooby-Doo meets Sandy Duncan.
Who the hell is Sandy Duncan?
Their bowling game is interrupted by evil robots, and they're chased into an alley where suddenly... Wait, what?
Gentlemen, welcome aboard.
Hold on, what's
it's
going on?
It's a guy named Dick Dastardly. Shocker!
Slow down.
He's a psychotic supervillain.
Hold on, can you slow down a little bit? What's going on?
Welcome to the Falcon Fury.
Why is this happening?
Nobody gets away from Dick Dastardly.
So, yeah, this is a Blue Falcon and Dino Mutt superhero movie now, complete with big air battles and action scenes. And again, these characters have done crossovers in the past, but for an episode or two out of a series, or in completely different Hanna-Barbera projects. A radical departure from the Scooby-Doo formula, after adhering to it pretty strictly through the introduction. This clash of intentions causes a severe whiplash, and this fracture reaches into several other elements of the movie. So it's about this point that a certain detail is bugging me. The sound design doesn't fit the animation. Look at this. Or this. Or at this. These elements don't fit together. Compare this to the cell animation.
We gotta get that key and get out of here. Got it.
See that? The animation is more expressive, more exaggerated, and it fits better with an exaggerated sound effect. In this movie, it's very distracting because the animation isn't caricatured enough to warrant the same treatment. The techniques don't quite fit together, and it's off-putting. Also, I want to take a moment to underscore how our character motivations here are really messy. Already we were on thin ice from a lackluster opening, but look at this scene where Blue Falcon invites Shaggy and Scooby along for the adventure.
Hello, adventure. Yes, will you take my name and number off your list?
So Shaggy happily refuses, but then Scooby says one line.
But Waggy, this is our chance.
Yeah, maybe you're right. We can show everyone we're not the weak link.
And that's enough to make him totally reverse course. There are no lingering doubts visible in Shaggy's mind, which makes his motivation very weak and unclear, which isn't a good place for us to be in a third of the way through the movie. These issues keep compounding and they hurt the movie on multiple levels. So, not a great first act, but let's keep going though and see where we end up. So a villain, Dick Dastardly, had sent to the evil robots after Scooby and Shaggy. Since they're important, the duo now has to stay with Blue Falcon and Dino Mutt and tag along for the adventure. While they don't know Dick's plan yet, they do know that he wants the three skulls of Cerberus, which he already has one of. We, the audience, also get our own perspective.
I need what's on that ship, or I'll never get my treasure.
This drives the... what are they called again? I don't know, the Falcon Gang. To search the globe for the second skull. Dee Dee locates one in the Gobi Desert, but Blue Falcon gets a message stating it's in Romania.
If it was a trap, why would Anonymous use his own name?
Wait, do you think Anonymous is the name of a person?
Oh, based on your tone of voice, I don't anymore.
Okay, so maybe this movie has some good jokes here and there. Anyways, Blue Falcon points the crew towards Romania as we cut to the rest of the mystery gang. Yeah, remember them? 3/5 of the cast of Scooby-Doo? They've been following up on the bowling alley attack, and they've discovered something.
Whoa, Scooby-Doo is the last descendant of Paritas?
Who's Paritas?
He was Alexander the Great's dog.
I'm sorry? Scooby-Doo is descended from the dog of Alexander the Great? We're going in this direction? We're going in this direction, okay. The Falcon Gang touches down in Romania, where, surprise, it was a trap. Dick Dastardly now has the second skull of Cerberus and springs his ambush.
Okay, Brian, we've had our differences, but this is the moment where we stand together and-
Run!
Classic Brian.
Okay, I will say this, I do enjoy Dino Mutt in this movie. Historically, his character in the Hanna-Barbera canon was a dim-witted goofball. This is obviously a total reversal of his character, but honestly, I don't think I could handle four dim-witted goofballs in this movie, so I welcome this change. And his sardonic quips, honestly, more often than not, do get a chuckle out of me. Though it might just be the fact that he's annoyed at characters I'm annoyed at, too. As the action in the park unfolds, Dick corners Scooby and Shaggy, and reveals that he doesn't really care about the two of them, just Scooby. Dick confronts Scooby-Doo in a funhouse in a segment that's actually pretty visually creative. The stark shifting colors, the way the mirrors play with composition, this is an interesting way to present the scene. I just wish the dialogue was a little better.
And I will show you how to harness your destiny and become the most important dog in the world.
It could have been, join me and no one will ever reject you again. Join me and you can be a hero. Hell, even just a slight change, such as join me and you'll become the greatest dog in the world, would sound more natural. As it is, it feels awkwardly written, like it's meant to more precisely line up with the character motivation. That is, Dick says, become the most important dog in the world, as if Scooby has articulated a desire to be an, quote, important dog. But that's not what we've seen so far. He just wants to be valued by his friends, and to stick it to Simon Cowell.
Take that, Simon Cowell!
Yeah, I'm so pissed that he's a major character in this movie. Hell, he's cited as motivation for these two more than any of the mystery gang. Anyways, they do eventually manage to get away from Dick, and upon hearing that Scooby-Doo is apparently the key to all this, he's inducted fully into the Falcon Gang. This makes Shaggy feel left out. Blue Falcon comes over to try and comfort him, and we get this moment.
That means a lot to hear that from you.
How do you mean?
Like your father was this great hero, right? So like you're expected to be one too. And those are big shoes to fill. The pressure is monumental, not to mention the imposter syndrome that comes with the territory. How do you breathe under the weight of all that?
Wait a minute. Yeah, I'm dead serious. As of right now, Blue Falcon probably has the clearest and most engaging emotional conflict within the movie. His showy bravura constantly comes into conflict with the fact that he has no idea what he's doing. Brian enjoys a superhero persona he inherited from his father, but he's incapable of living up to it. This is 100 times more interesting than Shaggy now sniping at Scooby because he's jealous.
Does this make my ears look big?
Makes your ego look big.
What did you say?
I said, fine.
Anyways, the mystery gang get kidnapped by Dick Dastardly for him to use as leverage. They manage to get out of their cell and discover where he's going, though, and radio the information to the Falcon Gang. But they also discover more pieces to the puzzle. Dick Dastardly has been obsessing over the gates to the underworld, the place where Alexander the Great kept the loot of his conquests, which can only be opened by the descendants of Alexander or his dog.
Dastardly's going to use Scooby to unlock the gates to the underworld.
Oh, this movie's insane. In the same room, they also find a collection devoted to a dog they don't know. But when Dick finds them, they ask about it. Apparently, Dick and his own dog, Muttley, had tried to break into the treasure vault before. He sent Muttley ahead first, and found out the portal was only one way. His dog has been trapped in the underworld ever since. Oh, so that's his treasure that he's trying to get to. Alright, that's kind of a neat idea, I guess. Again, more interesting than anything happening with these characters. The Falcon Gang arrives in the Lost World, apparently, and they land to find the third skull. But it's about this point that Shaggy and Scooby come to blows.
Just come with us.
Us? You're an us now? Well, what happened to us?
Again, the relationship isn't solid enough for this to be particularly emotional. If anything, Shaggy just seems like he's being a selfish jerk because we don't know enough about him to see any mitigating factors in his consideration. Contrast this with Blue Falcon and how he articulates his motivation.
He expects me to be just like my dad, and I'm not. All I need is a moment, a hero moment, to prove to him and the world that I could do this.
See that? Sure, it's preferable to not have everything spelled out, but at least it's clear to us. We know what's at stake for him. Why are all the best characters in the Scooby-Doo movie not Scooby-Doo characters? Anyways, they find the third skull in an arena protected by Captain Caveman, another Hanna-Barbera character that's done some crossovers with Scooby-Doo in the past. Blue Falcon and Scooby get thrashed, until the mystery machine crashes into the stadium. Shaggy had been sulking until Fred suddenly showed up.
dastardly kidnapped us and was holding us captive on his super awesome airship. Jeez, that thing is cool.
Or at least a rather unconvincing Fred doppelganger. Surprise, it's Dick, who now has the last skull and Scooby.
You'll excuse me, I have a treasure to collect.
Wait, why is the script still trying to play this as some kind of mystery? It's pretty damn obvious his treasure is Muttley. It's not going to be a twist like the movie thinks it's going to be. Anyways, the Falcon Jet is ruined, and everyone goes at each other's throats for the second act low point, until Shaggy pulls a character moment from thin air.
It's my fault. I'm to blame. I let my own jealousy break me and Scooby up.
And rouses everyone to go stop the villain's plan in the climax. Dick arrives in Athens, and he uses the three skulls to summon the gates to the underworld. Then he forces Scooby to open them, and on the other side is Cerberus himself. As everyone else tries to deal with the demon dog, Dick goes in to rescue Muttley, and they share a moment.
You're alive! You cantankerous clodite! How could you do that to me?
Kind of. They just barely squeak out amid the fighting as the Mystery and Falcon gangs finally team up and get the doors closed. However, the seal cannot be completed without a sacrifice. They can only be closed by the descendants of Alexander and his dog, so it has to be Scooby-Doo. Shaggy's an acceptable substitute, I guess. But one of them will have to be sealed within the underworld, and Shaggy sacrifices himself to be damned. To the underworld. I'm sorry, this is just too much. But, of course, there's some bit about true friendship that enables Shaggy to return, and they catch Dick Dastardly, and then they remember this is a Scooby-Doo movie.
Simon Cowell?
What? Okay, if they stick with this, it'll all be worth it. Every bad joke in this movie, every bad character moment, is worth it if this is the ending they commit.
Dick Dastardly?
We can't have nice things, can we? So the movie ends with them setting up shop and a dance party, yada yada yada, and it also ends with me asking one question. Seriously, why is this a Scooby-Doo movie? The strongest characters here are the people who aren't generally associated with Scooby-Doo. In the climax, Blue Falcon tries to call his dad because he feels like he's in over his head. He needs to be bailed out. And it's at this moment that Dynamutt convinces him to rise to the challenge. Gosh, that's a weird thing to say. But that's a character moment! That's the conclusion to an arc! Meanwhile, the film is left trying to convince us that Shaggy and Scooby's character arcs even happened.
Yeah, we've been through a lot.
We've grown.
Saying it doesn't make it so. I think a key issue here is the cultural weight of these characters. Scooby-Doo is a bigger brand, more people are connected to these characters as they are, and doing new things with them has a higher risk of backlash. The director himself said that he was concerned about treating them with respect, which is a harsh limitation to impose on yourself as a creator. These guys aren't nearly as prominent, which gave the creative team more room to reinvent them in ways that make them more compelling. The generic hero of the past becomes a pathetic man-child who wants to ride his father's legacy and cosplay as a superhero, and over the course of the movie, reality slowly creeps in on his lackadaisical lifestyle. That is interesting. I honestly can't remember seeing a superhero movie like that, and I think it's a fun angle to explore more. So, explore that more. If a movie is going to reduce 3/5 of the characters of an IP down to glorified background extras, and the last two down to passive characters with mangled story arcs, then it shouldn't use that IP. It should just use what it needs to tell a strong story. Scoob isn't a hopeless movie. It has good things in it. I can see the outline of something good or even great. But those good things don't connect together, and they're bogged down by unnatural dialogue and other bizarre choices that make the film feel not like a cohesive whole, but a mess of loose threads that barely resembles anything Scooby-Doo. That concludes this video. Thank you for tuning in today. If you have any other movies you'd like me to discuss, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And if you want more of me, you can follow me on Twitter or Letterboxd for more updates. Until next time, I'm Daniel Goldhorn, and thanks for watching.